some topics in robotics which are related to getting some work done by the robot. Okay, so I would describe the nature of the tasks you want to perform using these robots. You have already been given introduction to various types of sensors, various types of actuators that are commonly used in these robots, which drive these joints. Okay, and you have also been given some lectures on how to control these actuators to achieve desired motion. So in today's talk, first part of today morning's lecture, I would be talking about what is the type of desired motion we want to achieve. Okay, so you have to place these things together in your mind. You have already been taught, if you desire a certain motion, how to control an actuator to get that. So you have microcontrollers, you have some sensors fitted on the actuators, so you can take feedback and then do some control action to achieve the desired motion. Now, what is this desired motion? How do I decide this is the way the joint should move? That is what we are going to discuss in today morning. Okay, so our task is really what is called trajectory planning. So depending on the type of tasks you want to perform, I have given some examples in my lecture notes. I think the lecture notes is with you already. You may have a certain type of tasks where you say that just say pick and place. So I am saying that I just pick up this water bottle from here and then place it somewhere else. Okay, so this is what is called a typical pick and place assembly task. Here, from one workbench, I am picking up an object and keeping it somewhere else. Really, the path I am following is not so important. So these are what are called point to point tasks. Okay, that is why you would see in my talk also, in the schedule, it is given as PTP tasks, point to point tasks. But suppose on the other hand, you are using a robot to do say a painting job or a welding job. So two pieces are there and two pipes are there, and then you want to do welding. So there you have a particular profile of the weld you want to generate, and whatever is the robot that is driving this welding gun must make sure that the welding gun follows exact profile that you want. It cannot miss any points in between. It has to follow the particular profile that you want it to move. So that is what is called the continuous path kind of motions. So you have, you know, both typically both types of tasks. One are pick and place kind of assembly tasks, one is what is called a continuous path motion. Okay, so these are the type of tasks, typically broad classification that you can think of you may want a robot end effector to perform. And the way you would as a user look at a robot, the task you would like to specify in world coordinates, what we call as world coordinates. In the sense, supposing you look at this room, okay, this is your machine shop or something like that. So this is my world, okay, and I might define a set of coordinate frames, x, y, z axis, or r, theta, z axis, and so on and so forth, some coordinate frame. With reference to that, I can define that there is a machine shop here, there is a machine shop here at some locations, and the robot end effector must pick some object from here and keep it here. So my task specification usually takes place in world coordinates. So with reference to some XYZ coordinates, I keep fixed for this whole machine shop. So you must understand the problem domain before I get into the details, because once we get into the details, it may look like a lot of maths, but you must understand the problem physics where we are operating, then we get into some of the details. So as a user, you are worried about getting the end effector to do certain types of tasks, which is point to point, or it may be continuous path. Either point to point or continuous path is typically specified in world coordinates, because that is what you are convenient with, comfortable with. You know the coordinate frame that you are attaching to a particular machine shop floor. With reference to that, you can specify that so many meters here, so many, you know, meters above the ground, this position is there, you have to lift it, you have to orient it like this, and so on and so forth. But on the other hand, you are achieving this motion by controlling individual robot actuators, joint actuators. So at each, at the shoulder, at the elbow, at the wrist, as Prof. Ramanath might have mentioned to you about robot anatomy class yesterday, okay, at various joints you have various actuators. So you have to achieve this world positions by driving the motors which are going to be worried about joint coordinate frames. Within this coordinate frame, this joint is to be driven like this. Okay? So you have to link up these two coordinate frames. The task of a trajectory planner is to link up a user defined world coordinate frame jobs into the individual joints, how they have to be driven, link up the coordinates and then find out how to reach these positions and so on. Okay? So that is really what we are going to discuss for the next 1.5 hour or so. Okay? If you have any doubts in between, feel free to stop me and ask me. Okay? Now, I come from the mechanical engineering department. I am Seshu. I have multiple interests. Some of you know me for the book I have written on finite elements. They have mentioned to me that NIT Suratkal, they are using that. So I have multiple interests. I use computational tools, also interested in robotics because a lot of computational tools find applications in kinematics, dynamics, trajectory planning, control and so on and so forth. Okay? So let's go over this and see how we look at, therefore, a task, as I was mentioning, in the world coordinates it is prescribed in terms of, say, I have taken, because you probably haven't done too much of kinematics by now in this short course. So we are talking in terms of about 40 hours of theory course on robotics. Typically mechatronics is another 40 hours in IIT. So we are trying to compress it into about 10 hours of theory classes for your course purpose. So I have taken simple examples of planar motion so that you will be able to immediately understand based on simple trigonometry the relations that we are talking about. Okay? So in a two-dimensional example that I have taken here, supposing you think in terms of two links, okay, and then the end effector at the end of the links has to do some task. It's a simple mechanism I have taken into account. Okay, so you just don't have a wrist also there, it is very, very simple. So I have just a shoulder joint and an elbow joint and I want it to do some work. Okay, so these two joints have 2 degrees of freedom. So that is what I call as theta 1 and theta 2. So there is a motor sitting here driving this joint, there is a motor sitting here driving this joint. So I have 2 degrees of freedom, theta 1 and theta 2, I need to drive in a manner that I have to achieve the end effector position wherever I want. And this is specified in terms of the global xy frame, xy coordinates of the end effector point B. Okay? So now how do I relate it? This is a typical planar 2R manipulator, 2 revolute joints. So this is very, very simple example, but it illustrates the points that we are talking about. So I am sure you must have done this type of things before. It's a simple L1 in L2 are the link lengths. So X B, Y, B, that is in world coordinates, are related to the joint coordinates theta 1 and theta 2 of each individual motor sitting here and being driven. Okay? So X1 and Y1 are X, B, Y, B is L1 cos theta 1 plus L2 cos theta 2 and L1 sin theta 1 plus L2 sin theta 2 gives you Y, B. Okay? So I hope there is no problem in understanding this simple trigonometric thing. L1, L2, L1, L2 are being given to you. So for any given position, now the interesting point that I want you to observe is that given any joint positions, theta 1 and theta 2, it is fairly easy. Of course, link lengths are already known to you. So it is fairly easy to find out X, B, Y, B, where my end effector will be. It is very easy to find out. But the problem as a trajectory planning person is the reverse. For typical problems of trajectory planning, you are given XB, YB. You are of course given the link lengths L1 and L2. You have to find out the required theta 1 and theta 2 to achieve, with this link lengths, to achieve XB, YB. So given these left hand side things, you are trying to find out theta 1 and theta 2, two equations and two unknowns. But the problem is that these are sine and cos functions. So it is like nonlinear algebraic equations. Yes. You could do that, yes. I think in the previous picture it is shown as this is theta 2, this actually should have been with respect to the x-axis, and thank you for that. Yeah. Yeah, if you think in terms of a motor sitting on the first link driving the second link, or motor sitting and the frame and driving the second link, the difference is that. Okay. Thanks for pointing it out, I forgot to mention that. Okay. So given theta 1 and theta 2, to find xb, yb is fairly straightforward, but in trajectory planning problems you are typically told where the end effector should go, and then you are to find out how to drive the joints. So theta 1 and theta 2 to be found out. So given xb, yb, this becomes nonlinear algebraic equations, that is trigonometric equations to be solved. So multiple solutions will be there and so on and so forth, right? Sometimes you may not have solution, okay? All those problems will be there. That is what we will try to look at. Now, what it means is that for each position that you want in the world coordinates, the end effector should reach, I can find out corresponding positions that the joints should take, theta 1 and theta 2, corresponding to this position, corresponding to next position, next position, next position. For each position of the end effector, I can have a table, these are the joint angles that I need to go through, okay? So that comes from inverse kinematics, okay? So assuming that you have solved this inverse kinematics for your robot, okay, so you can achieve something similarly by differentiating these kinematic relations in relations in terms of the velocities and the accelerations, because typically you also have a time sense to these motions. You may say that, okay, if it is an assembly operation, you want this particular task to be achieved in a certain time. Okay. So that means you are automatically talking in terms of certain positions to be reached with certain velocities to be achieved. Okay. So therefore, we differentiate these things and then you will get this type of relationships. So this is x dot, y dot in the end effector coordinates, world coordinate frame, the velocities that you want to get for the end effector, and these are theta 1 dot and theta 2 dot. Wherever you see the sign end symbol, you please treat it as a dot. Okay. So you will have theta 1 dot, theta 2 dot related through the derivatives relations. Okay. Given theta 1 and theta 2 again, at a given position of the joints, it is fairly easy to find out. Given theta 1, theta 2, theta 1 dot, theta 2 dot. But here you are trying to find out given x dot, that is velocities of the end effector in the global world coordinate frame, you are trying to find out what is its joint velocities I need to drive at. Okay. Broadly, you have got an idea of what is a trajectory planning problem, but at the same time, some more aspects that we need to look at are, there are likely to be constraints, okay, in the sense that when I am driving a point, an end effector from one position to another position with certain velocity, okay, I need to go through certain accelerations therefore. But now I have some motor sitting there, okay, actuators are there. So they have certain torque speed characteristics, certain maximum accelerations that they can supply to this system with some finite inertia. So you will have some constraint on what is the maximum acceleration or what is the maximum torque that I can supply as an actuator sitting here. Okay. So you cannot get any arbitrary profile that you want with respect to time. You have some constraint in general. You also have a constraint arising out of dynamics of the manipulator. What I mean by dynamics is that it could be simple rigid body dynamics, because whatever we have discussed so far is kinematics. I tell that this is a geometry relation, and if I drive this actuator, if I position this, then the kinematics dictates the rest of the motion. But because of the finite mass and inertia of the links, the joint torques supplied do not automatically translate to these kinematic positions. That is one problem we will have. Dynamics, rigid body dynamics comes into picture. The other dynamics effects that comes into picture is the compliances. Joints may have some finite stiffness. Links also may have some finite stiffness. Okay. So what happens is that when I say that you move from this position to this position with some finite velocity and acceleration, it accelerates and decelerates. So inertia forces are set up. So when I go here to here, it does not only go from here to here, but as it reaches, it does vibrations and then settles down. Okay. So because of the inherent stiffnesses, compliances and the links and the joints. So therefore, I need to take into account So otherwise it would start welding in a zigzag manner when I ask it to follow a particular path. Okay. So these are constraints I have to take into account, dynamics and then compliances. So you may also specify some constraints on how the smoothness of the motion is. You may have some problems which we will come to towards the end. These Cartesian path constraints I would talk about towards the end briefly. You may have some constraints coming from the world coordinates, because for example, if I want to go from this position here to this position here, in between there is an obstacle here. So I cannot simply go like this. Okay. So there are constraints in that sense. Okay. So all these things have to be taken into account. So we are in a position now to kind of formally state what is the broad trajectory planning problem. Okay. So we may say that you are trying to move from an initial position to a final position via some intermediate points, I will talk about that in a minute now, within specified duration of time. As I mentioned, you may say that go from position A to position B within say 5 milliseconds or 50 milliseconds depending on your kind of operations, subject to constraints. Okay. Now, what is this via some intermediate points which we have not talked about right now? Okay. When you look at the particular constraints I have mentioned, supposing I am saying that this particular object is to be picked up from here and placed right on this chair. Okay. So I cannot directly take it like this. Okay. So I might actually say, how do I tell it to the robot? So I can actually say that you start from here. I know that these are the constant obstacles. So I may tell the robot that you start from here, you go via this point, you go like this and then clip it here, you know. So I am actually specifying some via points. Okay. These are points which need not necessarily be passed through. Important key point to keep in mind is that these via points are such that you may or you may not really pass through those points, but you have to pass close through those points with some finite velocity. Okay. So depending on how you specify these via points, these intermediate points are extremely useful. Okay, because as we go along, we would probably try and highlight that and see that when you specify these via points and require that the robot should pass through them with some velocity and so on, so it becomes tricky. Okay. So you could use the via points conveniently to do the trajectory planning. Okay. So we will go through these various steps. So now when I am specifying that from an initial position I need to go to a final position, for the end effector, through the kinematics I have transferred that problem into motion planning for each joint, because I know that x is L1 cos theta 1 plus L2 cos theta 2 and so on. So I can relate the xy specifications to theta 1 theta 2 specifications. So from now onwards, really speaking, I am going to talk about only how to get individual joint motions, theta 1 theta 2 and so on and so forth. This is really what I have mentioned here. We are talking in terms of joint space trajectory planning. Okay. So within the joint space, so for a given actuator here sitting, how it should drive the shoulder joint, an elbow actuator here, how it should drive the elbow joint, theta versus time. That is what I am really talking about. So let us consider one such joint. I have taken a single revolute joint. The degree of freedom is the angular rotation with respect to time. Okay. Say from an initial position I to a final position j, I am right now not talking about any via points. Okay. To begin with, to simplify the problem, I am not talking about any via points. So let us say that I want to move from position I to position j. At that position I may specify the position, the velocity and the acceleration in general, you know, right. It is possible that I reach a position j with some at that position with some velocity and with some acceleration. Some of these things you may not specify. Please understand, when we are talking in terms of specify, who specifies this? The user has to specify. Okay. Keep this in mind. So when we are designing a robot, putting it in operation, so you may give some provisions, But ultimately, the user has to specify all these things. So you ask too much information to be specified by the user, he may not really know how to specify that. Okay, so keep this point also in mind. Okay. So in general, he can specify position, velocity, acceleration, position, velocity, acceleration at the initial point and at the final point. Right? So I have put here as theta versus time. Okay. Initial position is this, final position is this, and then in a particular time duration. Okay. So one of the common things that is done is to use a cubic curve fit to go from an initial position to a final position. So you are starting from an initial position at time t equal to 0. In the final time tij, the reason why I have used tij is that the time taken to go from an initial position I to a final position j. So therefore, it is given the symbol tij, very intuitive to remember and use it. And the general time is tau, time tau. So I specify that theta of tau is c naught plus c1 tau plus c2 tau square c3 tau cube. Okay. If you use cubic curve fit, the idea is that this gives you a cubic curve passing through this initial position and final position with some velocity at the initial position and then final position. Okay. And then you will know the particular joint that you are trying to drive. This is the motion I need to get at every time step. Now I have a clearly defined equation which tells me from this position to this position how I should drive it. So that is the reason why we are doing a cubic curve fit. Okay. So initial position to final position in a time tij. Suppose you think in terms of initial position and velocity, final position and velocity are specified. These could be zero. You are starting probably from rest. That's fine. Okay. So at an individual joint, you might actually initially start from rest or from some finite velocity to a final position either at rest or at some finite velocity. Okay. So zero or non-zero values are perfectly possible. So I am going to use these four conditions, 1, 2, 3, 4. Four conditions are there. These four conditions I am going to use to determine C naught, C1, C2, C3. So when I substitute tau is equal to 0, this should expression should become theta I. Tau is equal to tij, it should become theta j. I should have reached the final position. When the time is tij, I should have reached the final position. And when tau is 0, the initial velocity should be theta dot is equal to theta dot I. And when I reach the final time tij, the velocity should be. So four conditions are there. I can determine the four coefficients C0, C1, C2, C3. So it's a fairly simple strategy. It is the simple curve fitting strategy that you will help you to plan the joint motion. Okay. I have just done through the maths. Okay. They can be solved. C0, C1, C2, C3 can be solved in terms of the initial position velocity, final position and velocity, and then you can plan the trajectory. I know how to actually now drive the individual motor. We are assuming that all the joints, now theta, I have taken the example of only one single revolute joint, but we are assuming that all the joints that are there, the shoulder joint, the elbow joint, the wrist and whatever joints you have, all of them will start and end at the same time. Okay, so that is what really we are assuming. We could plan it other ways also, but I am just taking a very simple case of coordinated motion. Every fellow joint starts at the same time and ends at the same time. So we have taken one such joint and we know now how to plan this joint. Okay. So once you know that this is the motion I want to achieve, okay, so please see this. So once I know that this is the motion I want to achieve, I have determined C0, C1, C2, C3 coefficients. So I know the motion I want to achieve. Okay. I start supplying the necessary inputs to the motor. The motor rotates. I have a sensor which you have already been taught. Okay, maybe you have an encoder or whatever type of sensors you may have. Okay, you may also have a taco. You may monitor the position as well as angular position as well as the velocity. You can come back and check with this desired motion whether or not you are getting this desired motion. whatever is the difference, you can use your microcontrollers to find out the difference, and then you have an appropriate control law, maybe a simple PID law, maybe a simple proportional integral derivative control, maybe an advanced control strategy, doesn't matter. Whatever appropriate control law you have, from the sensor input that you are currently having, this is the desired motion that I want to have, the difference between these two in terms of positions, velocities are minimized. So you are able to get as close to the desired motion as possible. This is the overall strategy that we follow for achieving a coordinated motion of a robot from any position to any position. Okay? If you have large number of points also, only computations increase. Conceptually, this is all that we are doing, nothing more than that. Okay? So this is the scheme of things. Various lecturers are coming. Professor Seshu came and taught you microcontrollers. Probably Professor Prasanna Gandhi came and talked to you about sensors and actuators. Yesterday Professor Amarnath talked to you about robot anatomy. Now I am talking about trajectory planning. But the subject is all integrated in this manner. So you desire the, whatever the tasks you want the robot end effector to perform. From the world coordinates, you convert it into the joint coordinates. From the joint coordinates, you do some strategy like a cubic curve fit or any other strategy. I will talk about other strategies also. You do that. So convert it into a desired motion for a joint. Once you have the desired motion, you have what is called that set point for your controller design, what you have to achieve. Then you have the actuator, you have the sensor, which keeps telling you what is the current position vis-a-vis the desired position and velocity, and then you try to minimize the error between these two. Okay? So that is how every instant of time the whole planning goes. Okay? Yeah. Now supposing you have, you know, n points in between. Okay? So from an initial position to a final position, but a via point is also specified. Then what you could think of, okay, I would not spend too much time on that. What you could think of doing is that you have this position here, you have final position is this. But in between you may say that from here I should go to this, I should go to this, then I should go here. Okay? So whatever we have just now discussed, you can apply to each set of two points. Between these two I can fit a cubic polynomial curve and then decide what the joint motion should be. Then I have done this, and then I go from here to here, I go from here to here, and so on and so forth. Any number of points that are there, it is no problem at all to conceptually do this. Okay? I think the necessary maths for this I have already given in the lecture notes. It is just repeated application of whatever we have discussed for a single joint. So between from here to here I do it, and then I do it from here to here, and so on. Only thing I have to keep track of is the fact that when I am going from here to here, whatever position and velocity I have achieved at this instant of time here, whether I come from this side or I take off here, there should be a smooth handshake. Okay? I should not have a discontinuity in these variables. Okay? So that is all that I have to keep track of. Okay? And again, conceptually, intuitively, that is very, very straightforward, that requirement that yes, you are coming from some position and then you take off smoothly. Okay? So you are having continuity of position, velocity, acceleration, whatever derivatives you can specify, you know, you can achieve. It's good if you can achieve them, but if you don't achieve them, it would mean that you are going to have slightly jerky motion. If there is a discontinuity, it means that you are going to have jerky motion. Okay? Many of you must have learnt driving, and then initially when you are learning driving, then you would know how to operate the clutch, how to operate the, you know, accelerator. You wouldn't know how to do this, then it keeps on going like this. Okay? So that is a jerky motion because you are not able to coordinate the release of the clutch slowly and then pressing of the actuator. That's all you have to do. You have to release the clutch and you have to press the accelerator. But that coordination till you get, the car would have experienced lots of jerks. Okay? Okay. So what would happen is that, okay, well, let's go back here. So when you are looking at n points. Okay. So, the user, if you are following our strategy right now, so please see this cubic strategy that I have just now mentioned. We are talking in terms of position and velocities, theta dots being mentioned, specified by the user. Now, if he has to do it from this position to the end position, say some 3 points, okay. So, the initial position and then 3 intermediate points and then the final position. So, total always it is n plus 2. If there are n intermediate positions, initial position and final position are always there, n plus 2 positions the poor fellow has to specify position and velocity. Only then you can work out the strategy. Okay. So, you are really asking him to specify too much of information to be given by the user. Okay. So, keep this point in mind. The second point, disadvantage I mean or drawback I want you to keep in mind, whenever in robot motions and so on planning, you specify, you require that the user specifies something, you must keep in mind that you are driving real physical joints. Okay. The user really does not see all this. User just sees that this should be picked up from here and kept somewhere there. Okay. While you are driving these individual joints. Okay. So, the position that he gives, the velocity that he gives, the accelerations that he gives may not be kinematically consistent. Okay. You are driving a set of links connected together through a particular set of revolute joints, prismatic joints, cam pairs, okay, all kinds of things. Okay. You know the kinematics. He does not necessarily know that. Okay. So, therefore, when you ask him to specify 100 different things, then it is possible that because there is a window, I mean you must have seen lots of computer interfaces, it asks for this address, that name, this mobile number, that landline, all kinds of numbers it asks, all kinds of data it asks. Because it is asking, otherwise it does not proceed further, he might give some number. You may not be able to, with your joint actuators, with these prismatic joints, revolute joints, cam pairs that you have, you may not be able to achieve at this position and velocity, you may not be able to achieve this acceleration. Then you are stuck. You cannot proceed. You have asked, the way you have defined your user interface and the control scheme and so on, or trajectory planning, you have asked the user to specify all this, but you have not provided him any way in which he can do this conveniently. Kinematic consistency he cannot check. He does not understand robotics the way you understand. Okay. So, you have to be careful when you ask the user to specify lots of data. So, this is a disadvantage of our present strategy. It is very, very simple. Given any position velocity, I just fit a smooth cubic curve. Cubic curve has C0, C1, C2, C3, 4 coefficients to be determined, and I am asking for 4 conditions. Initial position velocity, final position velocity, so my job is done. But it does not work out like that if you are talking in terms of a large number of via points. So, let us see how it goes. Okay. So, I have just now mentioned about this. So, user to give large number of data point, data specifications which may not be kinematically consistent, user interface may become a mess. Okay. So, I am talking about this particular example. Okay. Now, you may come back because of the constraints I have mentioned, kinematic consistency and so on and so forth. So, you may say that, okay, let the user specify the initial position velocity, final position velocity, he may specify the via points position, but he may say that you choose your convenient velocity, you know, I do not really bother. Okay. See, the particular example I am giving, supposing I am taking it from here, I cannot directly go here because there is an obstacle, the user knows that. So, he is telling you to go via this point. Okay. He does not really care what is the velocity with which you are going around this, because he has given you the total time available to you, that is about say 100 milliseconds or whatever it is, he has given you that. He does not really worry about the velocity with which you go through a specific point. He may tell you that you go through this point so that you will, you know, avoid all his obstacles or whatever things, and then you will go to the final position. So, your velocity you may choose, he gives you that freedom to choose, that becomes then more convenient for you as a trajectory planner, that you can choose a velocity that ensures smooth motion, you know, without any problems. So velocity to be chosen, that is what I have written here, velocity to be chosen by the system, meaning by your computer program. Okay, it can choose that trajectory planning program, it can choose that. Let us see how it goes. So I am talking in terms of 3 points specified, I, j, k, that means initial position, final position say, and an intermediate point j. Via point, I have taken one simple point to illustrate the basic idea. Okay, so you can have many more of these. Okay, and in each case I am specifying that from I to j you have a certain time t I j, from j to k you have certain time t j k. Okay, so the user specifies, you go from this position to this position via through this point here, and here you may do it in about 25 milliseconds, here to here you may do it in about 75 milliseconds. Okay, so he specifies the total time available to you and the initial position velocity, final position velocity and the intermediate position. He does not care really what is the velocity you achieve through that point. Okay, so that is another way of looking at this problem. So I will just show you how that can be solved. Okay, so I look at now 2 cubic curves segments. So I look at one cubic curve from I to j and then another cubic curve from j to k. So from I to j I specify one cubic curve, smooth cubic curve, and then j to k I specify another cubic curve. Okay, let me see how I can fit that. So each of them will have c naught, c 1, c 2, c 3, some b naught, b 1, b 2, b 3. Time goes from 0 to t I j here, and here I have t j k. So this may be say 25 milliseconds, this may be say 75 milliseconds, or he may give you 50 milliseconds, 50 milliseconds, whatever. Okay, within that you have the initial position, initial velocity, and the at time t I j you should reach this position, at the end of this time you should reach this position. Similarly, at time t equal to 0 here in this part of the segment you are at that position, and finally at the end of this time 75 milliseconds or whatever, you must have reached the final position with some velocity. Okay, but now please see that because you have used 2 cubic curves, you have to determine, to completely specify the trajectory for your calculators. So you have to specify 1, 2, 3, 4 each. So that means 8 constraints equations I will need. The problem has become a little more tedious the moment you brought in one extra point. Okay, let us see how it goes. So I have only how many equations here? 3, 4, 5, 6. So that means I can determine only 6 coefficients. How do I get 2 other fellows? Then only I will be able to solve this problem, right? 2 other equations, how will I get? I am going to say that when it goes through j, it has to have smooth continuity. Okay, that is exactly what I am going to say now. So at j, continuity of velocity and acceleration. Okay, theta dot, I request you to read this as dot for now. Okay, so theta dot is theta dot, whether you are coming from this side or taking off from this side. Okay, so theta dot is same, theta double dot is also same, that is accelerations are same. So 2 additional conditions are there. Based on that you can then, this is yours, you are requiring, because I am driving physical joints with physical actuators, bearings and links and so on and so forth. You want to achieve smooth motion. Okay, that is you are requiring, therefore that velocities and accelerations should be continuous, and you can work through the maths. So
I have point j, when
yes,
it is smooth change of the velocity.
You are not changing the velocity, it is same.
Same velocity. So means acceleration at that point is supposed to be 0.
No, no. Acceleration does not have to be 0. If I am passing through a point, acceleration, I may be actually having some acceleration.
Same velocity is
velocity, rate of change of velocity is acceleration. Okay. So velocity at that point is some 10 meters per second. Okay. I approach it from 10 meters per second. So when I am approaching it, it is 10 meters per second. So next instant of time, it can become 11 meters per second. Okay. I am not disputing that. Okay. So acceleration doesn't have to be necessarily 0. It could be 0, but doesn't have to be 0. So I just would avoid the maths, it is already there in your notes, you can work through that. It is a simple cubic curve strategy. So between I and j, I get 3 equations, between j and k, I get 3 more equations, and velocity continuity at j gives me 1 equation, velocity acceleration day continuity at j gives me 1 more equation, 8 equations in 8 coefficients c0, c1, c2, c3, b0, b1, b2, b3. Okay. So they can all be solved. Okay. If I were to ask you to sit down and solve it, you will run away from this course. It can all be done. Okay. You have a computer, microprocessor which can actually do these computations in real time. Okay. All those facilities are available now. Okay. Technology has advanced to an extent where you can all, you have to only understand conceptually how the whole thing scheme works and then write it into a program, and then the calculations are done internally. So all this, yes.
Why are we using that cubic curve? Is it because we have 4 equations at our disposal?
No, you are using a cubic curve, therefore you are looking for 4 equations. That is the way I would put it. Okay. I have just introduced one strategy. I will talk about other similar strategies also. Okay. It is that way. You are looking for 4 equations because you have to determine C0, C1, C2, C3. Okay. I would be happy if there are less coefficients here, less equations, perfectly fine. Okay.
Can you say that cubic curve will have more capability of the different curves compared to the binomial?
Yes. We have some advantages, but at the same time, very, very popular schemes do not necessarily use cubic curves. Okay. You have a simple trapezoidal velocity profile you might take. It is very easy to do. Okay. You may have more advanced strategies that we would just now discuss, both trapezoidal and advanced curves I will talk about. But cubic I have just taken as a simple example for you to immediately latch on to that. Okay. Yeah.
Sort of thing, that compass. In the case of a robot, you have to specify that initial pose and final pose.
Yes, it can. I am right now looking at, I am actually looking at one joint, because as I said, depending on the type of robot configuration you have, you can relate through kinematics, direct kinematics and inverse kinematics, you can relate it to the end position to all the joints positions. Okay. So I am right now looking at any one joint. I have taken the example of a simple 2-hour manipulator to illustrate that point, that these two are related, so you can always do the calculations in your joint space. And I am assuming that all of the joints are going together, therefore I can take a look at one joint to understand the problem first, then I can build it back to the total system. Yes. Okay. So if you look at now, in general, if I have an initial position to a final position via n points, okay, it was the case of I, j, k, so I, k, initial position, final position and one intermediate point. But supposing I have several intermediate positions specified, then between any two points I am going to fit a cubic polynomial. That means I am actually going to ask for a lot of trouble. So okay, n plus 1 cubic segments to be fit, and then correspondingly each cubic segment will have 4 coefficients to be determined. So I have to determine 4 into n plus 1 coefficients to be able to tell each motor that, look here, this is the trajectory you need to follow, and then the controller will take care that it actually drives it in such a way that it will follow that trajectory. But 4 into n plus 1 coefficients can be determined when you have 4 into n plus 1 equations. You have to solve those. Supposing you have 5 via points between an initial position and a final position, so 5 plus 1 is 6, 6 into 4, 24 coefficients to be determined and 24 equations to be solved. Okay. So, this that is the nature of the problem that we are talking about. I have just shown here how all of them, you know, in this slide I have just tried to capture that, don't worry about the equations, they will all come. Okay. Because at each point you are going to impose the condition that the position is that and velocity, acceleration must be continuous, smoothness of motion. So, therefore, you can really write down, I mean in conceptually, not you are actually not going to sit down and write it, but you can conceptually think of all the equations that you require are available there. So, it is a solvable problem. Okay. That is what I have said, all the just to reassure you on, you know, on a Thursday morning, that yes, you need so many equations, but all those equations are there for you. You can sit down and write them, and the coefficients can be found. The strategy we have just now discussed can be implemented. There is no problem with that. Yeah, now I have just, I mean, once we have understood how the cubic works, I wanted to wait till then to bring it to this stage. Why is cubic so important? It is just that it is a lowest degree polynomial that ensures velocity and acceleration continuity. Because I have taken cubic, okay, I am able to take velocity and acceleration at the intermediate point and ensure that it is smooth. Of course, as I said, it is easy to work with, okay, but we can also use lower and higher polynomials, there is no problem at all. I would actually illustrate how the lower polynomial is used, how the higher polynomials are also used. Okay. Then we will work out one or two examples. Let us see how it goes. Okay. Yeah, of course, this is an extreme case where I am saying that I move from position I to j with some position, velocity and acceleration specified by the user. Therefore, 6 conditions are there at the initial position, velocity, acceleration, final position, velocity, acceleration. Then you can fit a 5th degree polynomial and then work with that. Okay. But let us look at also a common strategy that is implemented, you know, which is not necessarily cubic. Okay. Let us look at how it this problem goes. So, I am looking at a particular robot end effector as a gripper. This has some mechanism with probably cams, linkages, whatever, whatever. It has some mechanism which is driving this. And this is the object I need to pick, okay, and keep it somewhere else. Okay. Typically, what is done is that you look at an initial position where you come. You these are things that we automatically do it. As children, I mean, we have learnt this task. But if you look at any toddler, then you would probably appreciate what I am just now going to describe. And look at it, robot program, from that point of view. So, if I have to pick up this particular water bottle, I have to set myself at an initial position close to this. Okay? Just think that I am a very small child, you know, toddler. Okay? The way a toddler would walk and come to that. So, I have to come near that, set myself somewhere there. Then I have to grab that. And the way I am grabbing it, I should not press it into the surface, because this is, after all, it could be a, you know, an operation where you are handling, say, in a Silicon Valley, I mean, you are fabricating lots of chips and electronics and so on and so forth. So, you are just trying to pick this and put it there. So, when I am approaching this, I should not approach it with a velocity that digs into that surface. So, I have to take care of that. I have to position myself at an initial position, I have to gradually grab it, I have to take it out. The way I take it out, the velocity should again not be by having any component that digs inside the object, you know, surface where it is. So, I have to plan all these things. You are almost teaching it like a toddler. Okay? So, that is what I have written here. So, and again, when you come into the final position, when I am taking it and finally keeping it, I should keep it in such a way that it is delicately positioned there. It is delicately positioned there. So, I have a final approach position and then final landing position. So, these are things which we, when we do jobs, we automatically, intuitively, a skilled laborer does these things intuitively. Okay? But we have to bring that into our program. Okay? Mathematically, we need to capture that. We have to convert it into a particular desired motion for the actuator, thereafter the controller can take over once you are able to specify it as a desired motion. Okay, that's why I have said here initial position approaching that, then takeoff position, then you have reached the final position, you are setting down it. There is one position just before putting it down, and then you actually final position, you put it somewhere. Okay. So it looks rather, you know, silly to talk about this like this, but you have to tell all these things into the program, then only the robot gripper will be actually able to achieve the task that you are asking it to do. Okay. You have to put all this into its head in a way that the actuators understand, the controller can understand. So for an individual joint, so what we are talking about is that you are going from an initial position to final position, all right, but you are actually going through a initial position, then takeoff position, you take off from here actually, and then final set down position just before the position where you are putting it down. So you go here, the set down position, and then the final position. Okay. So this is your total strategy of motion with respect to time for a given joint. Okay. So therefore, common strategy that is followed for this kind of motion that you would see in many industrial robots would be that in this portion, initial position, this is what is called a 4-3-4 trajectory. That means this is a polynomial with fourth degree polynomial, quartic polynomial. This is a cubic polynomial, and again I use a fourth degree polynomial. Okay. So that means I actually talk in terms of I to L. So this is I to, sorry, these positions are shifted a little. This is I initial position and then takeoff position and then the set down position and final position. So initially you talk in terms of a fourth degree polynomial, then a cubic polynomial, and again a fourth degree polynomial. But basic idea of cubic polynomial, if you have understood, a cubic polynomial will help you to do the quartic polynomial also very easily. All that we are saying that given a certain time that is available to you, given certain position specification, velocity specification, velocity time direction as well as magnitude, you may specify that the velocity should be directed only tangential to this surface and no velocity that goes digs into it, that component of velocity should be zero, that it does not dig into the surface. All those things you can specify. Okay. So correspondingly, as I said, that there are coefficients that you can solve if you want. This should be 4, sorry. So fourth degree polynomial will mean that there are 5 coefficients to be solved. Similarly, 4 coefficients to be found for a cubic, and so on and so forth. So you have to correspondingly write down the equations, solve them in terms of the specified variables by the user, and then you will be able to do this. So for, I have just illustrated here how all the 4-3-4 strategy, 4-3-4 strategy, therefore you have 5 coefficients, 4 coefficients, 5 coefficients. So 14 coefficients, and you can generate 14 equations to solve for this. This is a common strategy that is employed in industrial pick and place kind of robots, assembly robots. Okay. Looking at strategies other than cubic, I have illustrated one strategy which is a higher degree polynomial, 4-3-4. You may even have other strategies also, but just to complete the story, I want to give another strategy which is lower degree polynomial than cubic. So you can use that also. Okay. Simple trapezoidal velocity profile. This is what is this strategy telling. Please observe here that it is theta dot I am plotting here with respect to time. Okay. Trapezoidal velocity profile. So what I am saying is that if you want to go from here to here, simply follow a uniform acceleration phase, velocity keeps on increasing here for some small time, and then velocity remains constant once you have reached some velocity. Okay, from say initially 0 at rest, you are initially at rest here, you are moving from here to here. Okay, so from 0 you reach a certain velocity, say 10 meter per second, 1 meter per second, whatever it is, you have reached that velocity, you maintain that velocity now for some time. And then when you are approaching that, that is what you do. Okay, when you go in Bombay traffic from one traffic signal to another traffic signal, you are almost at rest at one traffic signal, you start off, you increase the velocity to 60 kilometers per hour or 40 kilometers per hour. 60 I think is too high nowadays for Bombay roads. So 40 kilometers per hour probably you can reach there, and then maintain that steady before you see that there is another red signal that is coming. Okay, so you now start decelerating to rest at that point, but in between you maintain 40, 50 kilometers per hour or whatever, so that at least you will get some little bit mileage from your fuel. Okay, so that is what is a very, very simple intuitive strategy here. Okay, it does not require your cubic polynomials and 4-3-4 strategy and so on and so forth. Okay, this is commonly employed again. Okay, there are some problems with these things, we will look at that. Okay, supposing you look at this strategy now, so velocity increases gradually. Velocity increases gradually meaning uniform acceleration. Then in this position from A to B, velocity is constant, that means acceleration is 0. Then you are going from B to C, acceleration is negative, you are decelerating down to 0 speed, okay, but uniform deceleration. Look at this, how it will be. Acceleration is uniform, some constant value, and then kadang, it goes to 0, it remains 0 for some time between A and B, then kadang, it goes to negative deceleration, some uniform deceleration, and then tadang, it again comes up and so on and so forth. So what you are really looking at is some jerks in this. It is a very simple motion to program, to implement, very simple strategy to understand and implement, but you are likely to have jerky motion. Okay, that is the reason why if you go back to cubic, you can maintain that smooth accelerations also. Okay, so of course you have some advantage here that it is simple motion, there you have advantage that you can get the accelerations smoothly. Okay, so you have to trade off the way you look at it. So you are essentially talking in terms of a parabolic profile in displacement time, displacement wise you are talking in terms of parabolic motion and then a linear motion, because uniform, you know, velocity is uniform, so it is linearly increasing displacement for that joint. Okay, it just goes from one position to another position linearly, velocity is at the same velocity it goes. Okay, so again a parabolic segment. So it is a fairly simple strategy to program, conceive of, implement and so on and so forth. Okay, so keep this in mind, all these things are used, but basically you need to understand whenever you are looking at broadly, I keep going back to that same thing, that you have a workspace, world coordinates, x, y, z fixed with respect to the world. You as a user think in terms of the end effector, where it has to go from one position with some orientation may be also required. So that means another joint, another actuator, so that needs to be specified. So you are looking at that, and then you are talking about a final position, maybe through certain set of points and so on. So you convert it into individual joints, and for each individual joint you have to use one of these strategies to convert it into a desired motion. Once you convert it into a desired motion, then your control strategy, microcontrollers, hardware implementation, everything will take over. Okay.
Zero velocity. And in a very short, instantaneously, then the next instant, the velocity is going to be have some finite value.
Right.
At that particular time, are there not going to be very high acceleration there?
That's right. That's right. So that is where I was saying that you have some constraints. Okay, that is your masses and inertias of the links that you are moving them with some finite size actuators. So the actuator can only exert this much of torque. Okay, so you would say that at no point of time your strategy should demand a higher torque than this. Okay, so you may want anything, but you must make sure that you do not demand from this actuator, this is all the actuator I have, this is the maximum torque I can achieve, you cannot ask for more than this. That automatically translates to a certain acceleration specification because of the masses and mass moments of inertia of the links. Okay, so those aspects have to be taken into account. Yeah.
And again there will be change in acceleration which will give rise to shock movement.
That is there, yes, that is there, yes. That we try to minimize by using, you know, other than this trapezoidal profile, if you are using the 4-3-4 strategy or a cubic polynomial and so on, you can make sure that, you know, jerks are minimized to a large extent. Yes. Right.
Then, if you plan for acceleration, if you plan the motion, the strategy for acceleration, then all of that goes hand in hand.
Yes.
Start from acceleration, then velocity of the scooter, and the, even the displacement and all. So, if you start from point of smooth acceleration, or smooth jerks, then we can go back hand.
Correct. Absolutely. You could do that. But as I was saying in the beginning, the way the task is specified is in actually world coordinates of positions and times. See, the user of the robot who is doing a particular welding operation or a pick and place operation doesn't really know how to specify this must be your accelerations or this is the tolerable jerk. He cannot specify those things. He specifies to you that this is the motion I want to get from this position to this position, and the time I can allow for this operation is so much. So, you are working backwards from there. So, you can work with, you first of all you convert it into joint motions, then you are dealing with displacement variables, but you can certainly do it with accelerations also. Sure, sure, absolutely, there is no problem at all. But finally, you have to come back to the displacement variables because the joint actuator drives it through those displacements. Yes, you could do that. Okay. So, I have worked through the maths of the trapezoidal velocity profile, looks this way. Another important point I want you to grasp, I am trying to take you through an exposure to the general problem of, you know, trajectory planning rather than trying to equip you with the various details of maths that goes with this. That maths is there in the notes that I have given to you. Those of you who are interested can sit down and work through the maths. It's also available in most of the books. I have taken it from the books only. Another important point that you may want to see, which I have illustrated here, is that supposing I am going from some position, initial position to another final position, okay, in a given time, through certain points here via points A, B and C and so on. If I am trying to fit through this, you know, trapezoidal velocity profile that I have talked about, where it is linear motion and then parabolic blends and so on and so forth, you may notice that when it is, if you see this thing here, I think I have shown that, okay, there is basically a parabolic fit and then the linear motion, most of the motion is linear because uniform velocity, okay, and then a parabolic fit again here, okay. So, now when I look at that kind of a strategy, when I am trying to get a smooth motion, I may not be really able to reach a via point because I am going through a linear displacement here and another linear displacement here. Unless I actually come to, when you talk in terms of theta versus time and a linear displacement, so the slope of that is actually the velocity. So, unless I come to rest at this point, I will not be able to actually pass through a via point. Okay. Earlier we didn't have this limitation. This is another thing that comes out. It's not just uniform accelerations, therefore jerky motion, but it is also important to realize that you may not actually pass through a via point. You may pass close to it, but you will not pass through that because then you are going like this, then you have to come. Okay. So, unless you come to rest there, you cannot do that. Okay. So, these are things you have to keep in mind. Some advantages, some disadvantages. Okay. So, I will just take one example problem and show how the calculations go through. Okay. Initial, the example that I have taken is from a 2R planar manipulator. So, you have two links. So, I have just for simplicity taken each link to be a 1 meter length. Theta 1 and theta 2 are the joints. So, I have A here and then a B is the end effector. Initial position of the end effector is shown. Okay, and then the final position is this. So, the final position I have specified and initial position I have specified, and I am telling that I want to go from this initial position to final position in about 1 second, let us say. Okay, let us see how the calculations go through. Okay, so first step I have tried to give it as first step is to convert the initial position specifications, final position specifications of the end effector in global world coordinates into joint coordinates. So I have done that here. So theta 1 to final, initial to final, theta 2 initial to final, and then x b y b are cos theta 1, 1 meter link lengths L1, L2, so that is taken as to be 1 unit. So cos theta 1, cos of theta 1 plus theta 2, my dear friend who has pointed it out to me. So when I was working out the example, I noticed that. So cos of theta 1 plus theta 2, because the motor is sitting here and driving this joint with respect to this joint, so it is okay. So theta 1 plus theta 2, and then you can find out the initial angle and then the final angle for each joint to be achieved. Okay. So 30 degrees to 150 degrees for the first joint, 30 degrees to minus 30 degrees for the next second joint. Okay. But the time available to me to do this is 1 second. Okay. Let us say that initially they are all at rest and finally they are all at rest for simplicity. If it is not rest also, you can solve the same equations. I have just taken it to be like that. So then what you are saying is, next step, you achieve this from 0 to 1 second, theta 1 and theta 2 as functions of time. That is what is the next step you do. One first step is through inverse kinematics, which Professor Seth is going to describe in greater detail, direct and inverse kinematics for more complex examples. Since you haven't done that yet, I have taken a simple 2-hour manipulator where you know cos theta 1, cos theta 2 and so on. Okay. So you choose that inverse kinematics, so you have got theta 1 and theta 2. Now you convert them into the cubic profiles within this time span of about a 1 second here. Okay. So theta 1 and theta 2. So I have done that. So then I get this trajectory. Time is 0 to 1 second and these two joints have to be driven in this manner. Okay. Step 3 is, now you estimate your xb and yb that you actually get. So that is what I have tried to do. Let us see how it works out. So this is trajectory for the first fellow and then the second link point. Okay. Theta 1 and theta 2 actually will go through like this. Theta 1 goes from 30 degrees to 150 degrees smoothly, and this goes from 30 degrees to minus 30 degrees smoothly like this as a cubic curve fit. So this is your desired motion that you need to get from the actuator. Now you specify this to your microprocessor, microcontroller that is driving the actuator, and the sensor encoder position sensor is there typically. So you are measuring the actual theta 1 desired is this, I can say that, theta 2 desired is this, theta 1 actual and theta 2 actual that you are able to achieve will be slightly different, and then you try to minimize the error between these two. I have now taken that from this initial position to a final position, but there is an intermediate position here I have specified, okay, which you have to pass through. So between these two points you have to pass through this position I have said. So now I have just said this is at this position, same height as this, okay, but at x is equal to 0, and this is say 0.5 seconds, this is 0.5 seconds for simplicity. Okay. Now what should be the intermediate position details? So one cubic I have fit for each joint, so that is intermediate initial position to the via point, via point to the final point position, so I have fit that, and then one cubic for each position, therefore four coefficients each, and half a second time frame that is available to me. Okay. So keep this in mind, that is the example that we are now considering. So I find that at the via point theta 1 has to be about 43 degrees. Okay. This is theta 2 unfortunately. So you work through the maths again, I initial position to the via point theta 1 and initial via point to the final position, another remaining half a second you should do that. So theta 1 is this, theta 1 final segment. So I will get now two profiles for theta 1, and similarly I can do it for theta 2. So this is your trajectory. So I am starting from here, this is my initial position, this is my final position, but I have to reach the intermediate position, therefore I have this intermediate via point position. So I go through from an initial position of the end effector to a final position via a point be here. Okay. So I have mentioned here that it is initially when I did not have any via points, only initial position, final position is specified, I start theta 1 to initial to final. But when I am specifying that I have to have a via point, I have to pass through that, then it is this. Okay. Similarly, for theta 2, when I did not have any via points, then it will look like this. It is a cubic curve again, but when I have via points, then I have to go up and then come down to minus 30. Initial position, final position remain the same, but in between I have to change. See, you would see here that I have to bend quite a bit to come to this position. When the initial link is here, first link is here, second link has to go like this. Okay. So that is why you would see the spike here. It would go up and then actually come down to minus 30 degrees. So just based on the cubic curve strategies, we will be able to achieve these targeted motions. Okay. You could use the trapezoidal velocity profile, you could use higher degree polynomials, or you could do other strategies as well. Okay. Now, one final comment before I wind up, which is that we have so far talked about specifying the trajectory planning problem in joint space. Not really. You might have asked me, for example, if I have to move from here to here, let me just, you know, do trajectory planning in that sense, in the world coordinates only. Because now, after all, nowadays you are talking in terms of, you know, some cameras being there, you are doing image processing, you are able to figure out where the end effector is. So why not I do directly the motion problem in world coordinates? Yes, it is possible to do that. But you need to find out at each instant of time where your end effector is in world coordinates. So x, y, z fixed there, you need to be able to figure that out. That means you should have a vision system or something like that, which will tell you where your end effector is at each instant of time. Okay. But then you convert it into joint space motions. Finally, you have to execute it through joint motions. Some points I just wanted to keep in mind, that when you are looking at this type of thing, I am not sure if many of you are aware, but we don't really have time to go through too much of kinematics. But you have to understand what the concept of reachable workspace. Okay, not all the points that appear in a world frame are reachable by your mechanism. Okay, within your total workspace also, some positions you may not be able to reach. So you have to take out those things, then only you will get actually a total envelope of workspace. Then actually you remove all these spaces that you cannot reach, then you would get a reachable workspace. For this, just to illustrate that, I have given here. So supposing we have just a single link and then the end effector joined like this. So when the end effector, whenever you look at this link OA and B folds back onto that, that is the circle that I have shown here. So any point within this circle cannot be reached. You cannot, of course, reach any point outside this circle because everything is stretched out now. Beyond that, you cannot reach. But when I have folded back, I cannot reach anything more less than this also. See, I cannot, with my tip, I cannot touch with my fingertip, I cannot touch any point beyond this. Okay. So there is a notion of a reachable workspace that you have to be careful about when you do these planings. So with that, I come to the end of my talk. I hope you have enjoyed the session. You have got an idea of how robot motion planning takes place. Of course, there are lots more issues involved in this. You are talking in terms of this. Here I am talking mainly, primarily concentrated about, you know, assembly kind of robots doing some particular tasks, or, you know, industrial robots. But if you are talking in terms of autonomous vehicles which have to go on their own, you know, then it's a different kind of things that they have to sense the obstacles that are there, okay, and so on and so forth. So they have to do this planning automatically, you know, in real time. They have to have a map of where they are. I mean, it doesn't know that there are steps here. It is an unknown environment for that. So it has to have a map. It has to figure out what is the environment in which it is operating, where are the obstacles, fixed obstacles, moving obstacles, vehicles may be coming and going, okay. All those things will be there. okay. Because when you talk in terms of AGVs now going over a shop floor, okay, other people are also moving, other vehicles are moving, this AGV should keep track of what are fixed obstacles, what are moving obstacles, and then decide how to, it should go, okay, and so on. So it is a complex problem, but we have got hopefully some idea of an appreciation of what the problem is and how it is specified, what we intuitively do some of these things. We intuitively cross the road, but if you sit down and try to track it down mathematically and program it into a machine as an intelligence that it can cross the road in front of IIT Bombay Adi Shankaracharya Marg, that would be great. Okay.